Collins.
Peter B. Collins, news and comment. It's Thursday, April 23rd, 2020. Our lead story today is about two autocratic leaders who are having a fight. In this corner, the dangerous autocratic leader of the Senate, Mitch McConnell. And in this corner, the kinder, gentler governor of New York, who wants to be an autocrat and sometimes acts that way, as they spar over efforts to provide bailout money to the states, who have been hard hit by increased costs and tax losses, revenue losses, because of the pandemic. But before we get started, I've got to share with you something that debuted just 4 hours ago, and I stumbled on it because of my daily scan of the news that includes the newspaper from London that's online only now, The Guardian. The Stones have a new song out that is the perfect theme for this pandemic time.
I'm a ghost, living in a ghost town. I'm a ghost, living in a ghost town. You can look for me, but I can't be found.
Now, if you're one of my handful of listeners on YouTube, this part might be blacked out. Oh, the music police and their AI bots are active all the time. But I had to share this with you because it is a great song and the music video is a must-see. The deserted streets of London really brought to you up close and in living color. And the song's so new that Mick is reading the lyrics off an iPad. I really recommend it to you. And, you know, I'm a recovering DJ, and I could not resist opening the podcast with that today. And the spat that has broken out is one where, despite my misgivings about Andrew Cuomo, and I do think that he is dangerous in many respects, because he is so seductive. He's got Obama's communication skills. And before we get into the dispute that's allowing playing out today, I just want to note that my view of Andrew Cuomo is very complicated. And when I reference Obama, his skill is drawing your attention to the moment and controlling your attention to focus on what he wants you to focus on. And so, for example, we haven't heard Andrew Cuomo admit that his very slow response to shutting down New York came at a critical time, and that we may not have a death count approaching 16,000 in New York alone if he had responded more firmly and sooner, as we did in California and in Washington State. Also, he hasn't admitted that his plea for 40,000 ventilators did come up short, and it pains me to see Crown Prince Jared have the upper hand in that particular argument. But the issue today is that Mitch McConnell has slammed the door on further bailout money due to the pandemic, and in particular, money that would go to what he calls blue state bailouts. I mean, he is so bare-knuckled partisan about this that it is overwhelming. And then he told that hard-hitting right-wing would-be Christian radio host Hugh Hewitt, "There's not going to be any desire on the Republican side to bail out state pensions by borrowing money from future generations." Now, that's what he reduces the twin impacts that I referenced: reduce tax revenues because people aren't working, people aren't spending and generating sales tax money, property values are going to go down or at least flatten, and not everybody's going to be able to pay those property taxes. So on the revenue side, states are getting hammered. and the hardest hit states that have had to spend hugely on coronavirus response, they're going to have big holes in their budgets. Now, California, we've got a surplus. We've got a rainy day fund. And it remains to be seen just how bad the damage will be here. But Cuomo is facing a real serious problem. And Mayor Bill de Blasio of New York City has already announced big budget cuts that's going to lead to furloughs of employees, reduction in services, a loss in quality of life. And so when the cities and states see airlines and banks getting huge bailouts in the first round, I think they are right to be outraged that Mitch McConnell is now suddenly a fiscal hawk. And as we'll get to in a couple of minutes here, the history of this, going to recent history in Mitch McConnell's home state of Kentucky, makes this politically even more bizarre. And get this, Peter King, the far-right congressman from somewhere in Long Island, a fellow Republican, called McConnell's remarks shameful and indefensible. So this is setting up a schism in the Republican Party. And by offering the idea that they would change federal law to permit states to declare bankruptcy, which is not currently available to them, McConnell said, "I would certainly be in favor of allowing states to use the bankruptcy route. It saves some cities, and there's no good reason for it not to be available." So, this is a draconian move. And while we don't have a clear critical comment or tweet from Der Trumpster, on Tuesday, he said after he signed the latest round of bailout money, he was ready to open discussions on help for state, local governments for lost revenues, much-needed infrastructure investments for bridges, tunnels, broadband, tax incentives for restaurants, entertainment, sports, payroll tax cuts to increase economic growth. So it appears that Mitch and Don are on very, very different scripts here. So I have linked to a 4-minute video, courtesy of The Guardian in Britain, of Cuomo's comments today, and I'd like you to hear a part of that.
Senator McConnell, who is the head of the Senate, you know, we've been talking about funding for state and local governments, and it was not in the bill that the House is going to pass today. They said, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, the next bill. As soon as the Senate passed it, this current bill, Senator Mitch McConnell goes out and he says, maybe the states should declare bankruptcy, okay? This is one of the really dumb ideas of all time. I said to my colleagues in Washington, I would have insisted that state and local funding was in this current bill, because I don't believe they want to fund state and local governments. And not to fund state and local governments is incredibly short-sighted. They want to fund small business, fund the airlines. I understand that. But state and local government funds police and fire and teachers and schools. How do you not fund police and fire and teachers and schools in the midst of this crisis? Yes, airlines are important. Yes, small business is important. So are police and fire and healthcare workers, who are the frontline workers. And when you don't fund the state, then the state can't fund those services. Makes no sense to me. Also makes no sense that the entire nation is dependent on what the governors do to reopen. We've established that. It's up to this governor, it's up to this governor, it's up to this governor. But then you're not going to fund the state government? You think I'm going to do it alone? How do you think this is going to work? And then to suggest we're concerned about the economy, states should declare bankruptcy? That's how you're going to bring this national economy back? By states declaring bankruptcy? You want to see that market fall through the cellar? Let New York State declare bankruptcy. Let Michigan declare bankruptcy. Let Illinois declare bankruptcy. Let California declare bankruptcy. you will see a collapse of this national economy. So just dumb. Vicious is saying when Senator McConnell said, this is a blue state bailout. What he's saying is if you look at the states that have coronavirus problems, they tend to be Democratic states. New York, California, Michigan, Illinois, they are Democratic states. So if you fund states that are suffering from the coronavirus, they're Democratic states. Don't help New York State because it is a Democratic state. How ugly a thought. I mean, just think of what he's saying. People died. 15,000 people died in New York. But they were predominantly Democrats, so why should we help them? I mean, for crying out loud, if there was ever a time you're going to put aside, for you to put aside your pettiness and your partisanship and this political lens that you see the world through, Democrat and Republican, and we help Republicans, but we don't help Democrats, that's not who we are. It's just not who we are as a people. I mean, if there's ever a time for humanity and decency, now is the time.
Well, Cuomo goes on, and I urge you to click on it and listen to the full comment that he made there. But to chime into his final remark there, there's no decency in Mitch McConnell. And Donald Trump doesn't have an ounce either. Now, I would conclude here, and you heard my opening comments about Andrew Cuomo. He's not a progressive. He is a double-dealing, shifty politician who slipped in that element to block or to permit his hand-picked election commissioners to remove Bernie Sanders from the New York primary ballot. But in this case, it is advantage Cuomo. And when I hear people who know how weak Joe Biden is as a Democratic nominee call for a backroom deal to replace Cuomo, I mean, to replace Biden with Cuomo, this is a very strong exhibit in his favor. Now, Nikki Haley, who was governor of North Carolina, then Trump put her in at the United Nations, she's angling, of course, for higher office in the near future. She piled on today in a tweet, states should always plan for a rainy day just like any business. I disagree that states should take and be bailed out. This will lead to taxpayers paying for mismanagement of poorly run states. States need to tighten up, make some cuts, and manage. Oh, wow. So, I want to turn to a really excellent analysis of Mitch McConnell and this call for bankruptcy and the claim that this is just bailing out pensions. And David Sirota, you may have heard his name. I've cited him recently. He was on the Bernie Sanders campaign as an advisor and speechwriter. He worked for Bernie years ago. He was a radio host in Colorado. He's a writer, and he's got a new newsletter that I've linked to. It's available at Substack. And he cites the Ford administration 1970s era headline from the New York Daily News when New York went into bankruptcy and the federal government said no bailouts. And the headline was Ford to City Drop Dead. And Sirota really nails it here. I encourage you to read this because I don't have time to quote every valuable item that he posts. But he talks about how the Senate Republican leader just finished shoveling trillions of dollars of federal largesse to businesses, billions of dollars of tax cuts to the super rich. And now he's saying there's not going to be any desire on the Republican side to bail out state pensions. That phrase is key, by borrowing money from future generations. Now, what Sirota points out is that Kentucky has a serious pension crisis. And Mitch McConnell just blows right past that and focuses on the blue states that have underfunded pensions. And it's a fact. And I don't exclude California from that. Illinois has a pension problem. But Kentucky is in very clear red ink. The gap between promised benefits and current resources in the bluegrass state, the Commonwealth of Kentucky, is estimated between $40 and $60 billion. One of the state's pension funds is less than 15% funded. And Sirota says the shortfalls are the result of state lawmakers repeatedly refusing to make annual contributions to the system, the investment losses from the 2007 meltdown and the current downturn, risky hedge fund investments that generated big fees for politically connected Wall Street firms who are big donors to Mitch McConnell and his Senate campaign funds. The pension emergency in KY has become so dire that teachers staged mass protests last year, and it led to a PBS Frontline show that exposed the seriousness of this problem. And Sirota later writes here, instead, McConnell is proposing to empower states like Kentucky to declare bankruptcy, a financial maneuver that in practice could allow states to reverse their promises, slash retirees' promised health benefits and subsistence incomes. For retired teachers in Kentucky, a state declaration of bankruptcy and subsequent reneging on promised benefits might mean huge cuts to fixed incomes and medical coverage in the middle of the pandemic. And this is my comment. It's kind of a let-them-eat-cake mentality. And to personalize it or, you know, make it specific to Kentucky, let them dig coal is essentially the message that he is promoting. So I want to thank Faith Peoples, a super listener and major subscriber to the Peter B. Collins podcast, who tipped me off to this important blog post from Diane Ravitch. She is a professor of education at NYU, and I didn't have time to look it up, but I think she used to write a column, an ad column that was published in the New York Times every week for the National Educational Association. That's a teachers' union. So she posts today, the right-wing extremist Heritage Foundation has issued its own report on how to recover from the pandemic. They cover it with patriotic glitz to make it appear like a government. It calls itself the National Coronavirus Recovery Commission. But its recommendations boil down to this: eliminate public schools and certified teachers. Here's a quote on page 5. The commission recommends that states help families return to work with access to K-12 education by making existing education funding student-centered and portable. Now, if this already conjures up the shift to charter schools and for-profit education, you're thinking in the right direction. Continuing to quote here, many parents and guardians who now find themselves in charge of teaching and monitoring their children's educations are unable to access the public schools they pay for through their taxes and are looking for continuity in their children's education. States should immediately restructure per-pupil K-12 education funding to provide education savings accounts. And that's just another term for vouchers. Research suggests, they continue, that there is little, if any, difference in student academic outcomes between teachers who are traditionally certified, alternatively certified, or not certified at all. So, yeah, anybody can teach. Now, this is a thinly veiled effort not only to promote charter schools, but to decimate public education and, on the way, take out the public teachers' unions. That is the kind of opportunism that we see coming from the wealthy conservative interests at this state of crisis in our country. The New York Times has a good report today on the problems that many people across the country are having getting access to their unemployment benefits, including the $600 a week federal boost that was one of the best elements that the Democrats negotiated in the CARES Act. And they note that only 4% of 850,000 pending claims in Florida have been paid. 4%. That is stunning. And Florida is not the only state. Most Republican-led states have basically failed to invest in their unemployment departments. And because they have computer systems from the 1980s, or if they're lucky, the 90s, they have been overwhelmed by the flood of claims that have been filed. And Ron DeSantis, the guy who opens beaches and lets people spread the virus, the guy who narrowly won the governorship at the recent, I think it was 2018, he's the one who acknowledged that only 4% of those 850,000 pending claims have been paid. And a national expert at the Employment Law Project in Washington, Michelle Evermore, is quoted, Florida's a terrible state to be an unemployed person. It's hard to get in. Once you do, it's easy to get disqualified. The benefit level is way below average. It maxes out at $237 a week. And so it is a real critical issue. And I use this to define the situation, the milieu, that Rush Limbaugh, the right-wing pundit who feeds talking points to Fox News, to the Trump White House, who lives in a fancy mansion in Palm Beach and has made way too much money, hundreds of millions over the years, as a right-wing syndicated radio host. Well, he was feigning compassion when I punched up on his show this morning for the people who are not getting paid or getting their unemployment. As Mitch McConnell threatens to cut off the states and let them go into bankruptcy. And Rush uses this as the way to spin up the whole effort that is funded by right-wing nuts, and we'll expose more of that in a minute here, the so-called liberate movement or the anti-quarantine movement in this country. And it is just stunning to see the lies that are used to, on the one hand, rationalize this phony movement of mini mobs, and to ignore the failure of Republican state governments to be able to even minimally respond to this crisis that they could see coming, at least months ahead of time. But the less government, low tax crowd that has simply stripped state governments of most of the fundamental services that citizens rely on? No, they're not at fault. It's the Democrats. I heard Limbaugh say that. He kind of just at one point was running out of gas, and he just shifted to a reflexive attack on. But it wasn't Democrats who eviscerated state government in Florida. And it's not Democrats who want to shortchange, even Florida, in bailing the states out from the unexpected damage of this whole episode. So next we move to Kemp. He is the really dumb governor of Georgia. He engineered his own stolen election over Stacey Abrams. We've covered that with Greg Palast in detail on this podcast. And in an effort that I can only believe was to plant big wet kisses on both of Trump's ass cheeks, he's the one who got out front. Yeah, we're going to liberate Georgia. We've only been locked down for 3 weeks because I was one of the last to impose any restrictions. And we're going to start off by lifting the restrictions on businesses that include hair salons, bowling alleys, tattoo parlors. Now, just how essential are tattoos, friends? You got to get your ink on. And it also includes massage parlors. And when I heard about that last night, I put up a little tongue-in-cheek post on Facebook, and I said that, you know, Georgia is lifting restrictions on massage parlors, and that this won't have a quote-unquote happy ending. And I think most of you know what I mean by that. Well, get this. Con man Don decided to turn on his supplicant, Governor Kemp.
I told the governor of Georgia, Brian Kemp, that I disagree strongly with his decision to open certain facilities which are in violation of the phase one guidelines for the incredible people of Georgia. They're incredible people. I love those people.
Oh, we all love them.
They're great.
Yeah, great.
They've been strong.
Strong.
Resolute.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, he must do what he thinks is right. I want him to do what he thinks is right. But I disagree with him on what he's doing. But I want to let the governors do. Now, if I see something totally egregious, totally out of line, I'll do. But I think spas and beauty salons and tattoo parlors and barbershops in phase one, we're going to have phase two very soon, is just too soon. I think it's too soon.
Now, this is such gibberish and incoherent. I don't need to remind you that this was the joker who was going to open the whole country back up by Easter. And he has been from the podium, as he did in this clip here, he read that. It wasn't one of his, off-the-cuff vituperative comments. And he didn't get around to attacking the reporters in the room yet when he delivered those comments. But this is such fucked-up leadership. There's no other way to describe it. And if I offend you with my strong language, I hope it gets your attention and it will pass. But we really need extreme language to describe this. This poser who offers disinformation and snake oil advice on a daily basis, he has propped up and amplified the Liberate movement. Again, we'll get to that momentarily here. Trying to build a counterforce so that he could say, well, the people want this and they don't care who gets sick or who dies or what the true costs of the pandemic are. And when you see that the failure of state governments to provide the minimal relief from unemployment benefits, we haven't even talked about welfare or the cutbacks in food stamps. This is so cynical and vicious. And it doesn't represent any kind of leadership. It's just posturing. All right. So if we call Brian Kemp dumb, then we must call the mayor of Las Vegas, Carolyn Goodman, dumber. Because she told Anderson Cooper last night that she wants restaurants open. I want our small businesses open. I want people back in employment. She wants the big casinos open. And the curves haven't been flattened in Las Vegas. It's a relatively low permanent population there, but 150 deaths are attributed to the coronavirus so far. And I really wonder what the odds makers. You know, you can place a bet on almost anything in Las Vegas. But what do the odds makers say about this? And Mayor Goodman, who says she's not a gambler, says she wouldn't be in the casinos because, first of all, I have a family. But, you know, she even said that she had offered for Las Vegas to become a control group. We'll just roll the dice and see what happens here. And these are really bad odds. I've got a quote here from Jimmy Kimmel, who grew up in Las Vegas. He said that she's bonkers and she should have resigned before lunch arrives today. And I'm laughing, but it is a very, very bleak, dark humor to see these idiots on parade. And you can dispute the, you know, the numbers and all kinds of things that this is overblown. But do you really want to take risks of these dimensions? So, on to the anti-quarantine protests. And I want to note that I don't read every page of every newspaper every day. But I do look at the homepage in detail of both the New York Times and the Washington Post. And to date, the New York Times is derelict in its duty to expose who is behind these faux populist astroturf efforts. And to its credit, the Washington Post, which earns my ire on many occasions, many days, they've been on this story, and this is the second one I've seen in a week. Let's give credit. The bylines are Tony Rahm with two M's and Isaac Stanley Becker. They say that the Facebook posts that gin up these mini protests around the country are funded by an initiative called Convention of States. They were not the product of grassroots uprising alone. They represent one salvo in a wide-ranging, well-financed conservative campaign to undermine restrictions that medical experts say are necessary to contain the virus, but that protesters call overkill and whose economic fallout could damage Trump's political prospects. They write, a network of right-leaning individuals and groups, aided by nimble online outfits, has helped incubate the fervor erupting in state capitals across the country. The activism is often organic and the frustration deeply felt, but it is also being amplified and in some cases coordinated by longtime conservative activists. And they name names. And we'll get to those names in my next breath. But this lengthy expose in the Washington Post doesn't touch the corporate media. They don't even mention Fox. But CNN is complicit in promoting this. To a lesser extent, MSDNC. But they should also take a swipe at the New York Times, as I have. It allows opinion columns that expose this same information, but I have not seen it in the news columns. So, do you remember the Mercers? They're the ones who put Steve Bannon on the board of Cambridge Analytica and ran that company during the 2016 election. They were, I think, next to Sheldon Adelson, the biggest donors to the Trump campaign, and he clearly wasn't their first choice. And Ron DeSantis, the governor who's presiding over the mess in Florida with 4% payment on unemployment claims, he's been a supporter of the Convention of States, which is aimed at curtailing federal power. It's now leveraging its sweeping national network and digital arsenal to help stitch together scattered demonstrations across the country, making opposition to stay-at-home orders appear more widespread than is suggested by polling. And Eric O'Keefe, board president of the parent organization of the Convention of States, says, oh, we're providing a digital platform for people to plan and communicate about what they're doing. Well, he's a longtime associate of the conservative activist Koch family. He helped manage David Koch's 1980 bid for the White House. He lives in Wisconsin, and he said, well, to shut down our rural counties because of what's going on in New York City, or in some sense Milwaukee, is draconian. And polls suggest that 71% of people support continuation of the restrictions. You've got Bill Barr threatening to sue states that vaguely, he says, go too far. The protests are reminiscent and linked to the same people who launched the Tea Party Patriots back in, 2010? The president of one of the groups here, he's the president of the Convention of States, Mark Meckler. He was a co-founder of the Tea Party Patriots. They're funded by FreedomWorks. Who writes the checks to FreedomWorks? The Koch family. So it's an insidious network, and as I have been railing for several days now, almost a week, it's phony. And when you add in the gun rights people who think the NRA is too soft, it gets really scary. And just one more bite here from the Washington Post article. It cites Stephen Moore, who Trump tried to put on the Federal Reserve, and even the Republicans couldn't stomach that. He was a Trump campaign advisor in 16, And he said, hey, I promise to pay the bail and legal fees for anyone who gets arrested. And this is where he invoked Rosa Parks. We need to be the Rosa Parks here and protest against these government injustices. Now, Rosa Parks was the one who integrated lunch counters. And I think she took an infamous bus ride to help desegregate Alabama 50-plus years ago. And for these white oligarchs to invoke her name is stunningly disgusting. So where's the money coming from to pay for the bail and to help out funding this phony movement? Well, we turn to The Guardian, as I didn't find this in any American media outlets. Liz Uline, the billionaire behind Wisconsin's Uline Shipping and Packaging Company. They do office supplies, all kinds of things. She and her husband, Richard, described as the most powerful conservative couple you've never heard of, is using their clout to try to force Wisconsin's Democratic governor to relax the stay-at-home rules, claiming that the crisis has been overhyped by the media. Now, Liz rarely gives interviews, but apparently she'd never heard of The Guardian, and she picked up the phone and talked to him. It's overhyped, she said, and I don't wish anybody ill will. You know, I don't wish that, but I think it hurts certain ages in certain places and largely in a lot of parts of the world. In the country, it's not as rampant as the press would have you make it. And she complains that the new hygiene requirements at their company, which is deemed essential, it makes something that would take 5 minutes to get done at the office now take 2 days. So that's her deep thoughts, her rationale for funding parts of this phony national effort. And this is where the New York Times did something right. They published a great op-ed, I've linked to it in the show file for this podcast, by Lisa Graves. She's now executive director of True North Research and the curator of Koch Docs. And she spent many years at the Center for Media and Democracy in Madison, Wisconsin. They've done great work. They exposed ALEC, the right-wing legislative lobby group. And she said she's been researching the Koch brothers since 2009. There are links to the Tea Party and Mark Meckler, who we mentioned. She says the protests playing out now have the same feel as the Tea Party protests aided by Koch-financed Americans for Prosperity and others a decade ago. Look no further than the first protest organized by the Michigan Conservative Coalition and the Michigan Freedom Fund, whose chairman manages the vast financial investments of Dick and Betsy DeVos, the Amway fortune, Stephen Moore at the Heritage Foundation, a Koch ally, Trump advisor. He admitted his role. And so she does a great job here of tying a law firm that represents Trump, the Convention of States that we just mentioned, and a fresh item, a Koch-financed public relations firm in pursuit of is purchasing domain names tied to protests to open the states, suggesting that they're investing for a long battle. And then we get to the really fringe, dangerous, self-styled militia types. And here's a decent report from BuzzFeed today exposing how a couple of weeks back on April 11th, one of the people who adopts the moniker of a Boogaloo boy, 36-year-old Aaron Swenson in Texarkana, Texas, he was roaming around on the night of April 11th, broadcasting his intentions. He was live on Facebook, looking for a cop to kill. So the police logged onto Facebook and watched his ravings. It led to a high-speed chase before he eventually surrendered. He was wearing an armored vest, had several loaded weapons in his truck. And BuzzFeed reports, for months leading up to the incident, Swenson had been sharing memes from Boogaloo pages on Facebook. And apparently there are multiple pages with thousands of followers. Now get this. Facebook will flag and use artificial intelligence to make sure that you don't see the posts from people who are critical or contrarian on various aspects of this pandemic and the response. And I defend their free speech rights even if I don't agree with their points of view. But for Facebook to allow continued posting from these identified, potentially violent groups that call themselves Boogaloo Brothers or Boogaloo Boys, it's completely indefensible. Wow. For a interesting commentary on the pros and cons, and there are difficult choices to try to evaluate how many deaths are acceptable, what level or rate of infection is acceptable as background noise before you can, quote-unquote, reopen the government. Peter Baker is the kind of big-picture analyst for the New York Times. And I think he gets down into some calculations that I don't think have much meaning. But he does acknowledge that any plan to begin restoring public life invariably means trading away some lives. And the question is, how far will leaders go to keep it to a minimum? And with this ginned-up effort to reopen, and you've probably seen the picture of that guy who basically said, let the weak die. A very Darwinian point of view. On the other hand, and I acknowledge this as a rational person, we cannot prevent all infections. We can't prevent all hospitalizations, and some people will die from this no matter what we do. But the Hobson's choice and the godlike decision is one that I don't have to make. And I acknowledge just how difficult it is. China has reported a new flare-up of infections in the city of Harbin, a city of 10 million in northeastern China. The numbers are a little bit low, but it's interesting that China is reporting it at this stage, 78 people with new infections there. And on the front page of my San Francisco Chronicle today, the latest from California Governor Newsom, who said he's not ready to set a date to lift the stay-at-home orders, and that testing is the central issue. Last week, he said that his goal was 25,000 daily tests of Californians, and we're only at 16,000 per day. And the experts, if you want to call them that, say that for our population of nearly 40 million, that we need 60 to 80,000 daily tests in order to have a big enough sample to make these difficult decisions. And I know Newsom. I generally like him. But I have to say, Gavin, let me address this to Andrew Cuomo and to the Trump White House. Why haven't we been planning much sooner, like the day that the stay-at-home restrictions were put in place? Why haven't we been setting up the testing requirements, gathering the chemicals, the reagents, and the swabs, setting up locations? And they are working on it. I'm not here saying absolutely nothing has been done. But Cuomo was on Trevor Noah's Daily Show last night, and he was saying, well, he was at the White House, I guess, on Tuesday, and he said that the air was frosty, that's my term, between him and Trump, but they did come away with some agreement on the testing that is required. Why didn't they have that meeting at least a month ago? So that's my comment. And here is our daily coronavirus update prepared by Linda Lewis. The worldwide death count is estimated at 187,000. In the United States, the number has climbed to 47,200 as of today from Johns Hopkins, and those numbers are usually a little bit behind. 26 U.S. Navy ships currently have cases of coronavirus. And the Pentagon tells us that there are currently 90 ships at sea with no reported cases. On, let's see, we have a total of 297 active duty warships. So most of them are in port right now. But when we're told that 90 ships at sea have no reported cases, is that what we could call the Crozier effect? Brett Crozier was the captain of the USS Teddy Roosevelt. He was sacked because he demanded treatment for his sailors. And now the demand that he had made for 4,000 of his sailors to be let off the ship, to be tested and quarantined if necessary, that is the state of affairs. And the Navy said, well, you know, we can't do that many. But that's what has come about. So as of Wednesday morning, 3,578 U.S. service members have tested positive for the virus, 800 of those cases from the Teddy Roosevelt, where Captain Crozier was infected. Haven't heard an update on him recently. So we are learning now. We keep learning more and more about this virus and the pandemic it's led to. New York City has confirmed that its first case of coronavirus was on March 1st, but at that time, thousands of infections were already silently spreading through the city. Hidden outbreaks outbreaks were also spreading almost completely undetected in Boston, San Francisco, Chicago, and Seattle, long before testing showed that each city had a major problem. And this comes from researchers at Northeastern University. And one of the interesting things about this from the pretty detailed report in today's New York Times is that on March 1st, the estimate is that San Francisco had just under 10,000 unidentified cases, and New York had just over 10,000. And you know, the populations are sharply different. The official population of San Francisco in the city and county limits is under 700,000. And New York city limits, I don't know exactly, but it's upwards of 6 or 7 million. And so California shut down about 2 weeks before New York went into the process. Our stay-at-home order was issued on Thursday, March 12th. And we had been given a warning a few days before by the county health officials. And this is one of the cases where Andrew Cuomo doesn't really admit that he should have acted sooner. And remember, during that roughly first 2 weeks of March period, he laid out a plan that never made sense to me where, well, we're going to reduce the workforce by 50%. And ultimately, he had to modify that. And we have more deaths worldwide than have been reported. At least 28,000 more people have died over the last month than the official death counts report. That's based on mortality data in 11 countries. We're also hearing new reports about ventilators. And by using them more sparingly, physicians could reduce the more than 50% death rate for those who are put on the breathing machines. This comes from an international team of physician researchers. And, in that case, I do understand that our research and knowledge of this is evolving. Also, separate reports that due to the high level of inflammation that the virus causes, many doctors from around the world have been witnessing signs of blood thickening and clotting in different organs. Recently, a new symptom dubbed COVID toes has begun to show up. People are going to their dermatologist complaining of red or purple toes, itching and burning. And it's believed that the symptom is related to COVID. Not only that, in Switzerland, a geriatrician at the University of Lausanne Hospital has put together a list of typical and atypical symptoms in older COVID-19 patients. Now, I'm going to read this for you, and you're going to think of the TV commercials for various pharmaceuticals where they are required by law to list all the side effects. Included on the atypical list are changes in a patient's usual status, delirium, falls, fatigue, lethargy, low blood pressure, painful swallowing, fainting, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and the loss of smell and taste. So this is a wily and insidious virus. And, as I say, we continue to learn more about it all the time. For example, here is another report from Northwell Health Hospitals on Long Island. Less than one-third of COVID patients hospitalized had a fever when they were first examined. Even though fever is viewed as a key indicator and we're told that to reopen, we're going to have these temperature guns or gauges that workers or restaurant patients will have to submit to before they're allowed in. But if only a third have fevers, that's hardly an effective marker. The Conservative Prime Minister of Australia is pushing for the World Health Organization to be overhauled. And one of the key things is that he wants recruitment of investigators similar to weapons inspectors. And this is one of the cheap shots that Trump has been taking. The WHO currently has no enforcement capability. And so I think that is a reasonable issue to raise. And I don't think I've talked too much recently about the World Health Organization, but I want to acknowledge it has scandals in its past. It is led by a man who has been described as a terrorist in his own country. And so I don't whitewash the World Health Organization. But for Trump to move to defund it at this critical time is only going to hurt people in the less fortunate countries of the world. So one of the episodes of the Trump, TV special that he presides over every day occurred yesterday. And essentially, he forced the head of the CDC to try to walk back comments. And Dr. Redfield, Robert Redfield, he was put in a position that reminded me of those old Western movies, where the bad guy points his gun at your feet and says, dance. And so the issue was that Trump tried to rewrite a comment that had been quoted of the director in the Washington Post. Trump, he was totally misquoted in the media on a statement about the fall season and the virus. Totally misquoted. I spoke to him. He said it was ridiculous. He was talking about the flu and corona coming together at the same time. And corona could just be some little flare-ups that we'll take care of. We're going to knock it out. We're going to knock it out fast. And then treading lightly so as not to inflame the orange monster, Redfield said, well, the headline was bad, and I want to emphasize what I didn't say. I didn't say that this was going to be worse. I said it was going to be more complicated, more difficult, potentially complicated, because we'll have flu and coronavirus at the same time. And when a reporter pressed him, Trump tried to interrupt by telling the reporter who was pressing him that he hadn't been called on, like grade school. And ultimately, Dr. Redfield said, yes, the Washington Post quoted me correctly. Now, over at The Intercept, they did a pretty good job of breaking this down, opening with the way Trump badgered Dr. Deborah Birx, who is the Happy Talk epidemiologist. And Trump asked her a loaded question. Doctor, wouldn't you say there's a good chance that COVID will not come back? As she began to respond, saying, we don't know, Trump cut her off. And he added that if it does come back, it's in a very small confined area that we put out. The great thing is, he said, blustering and bullshitting, we'll be able to find it earlier. Oh, I'm sorry, that was her comment. The great thing is we'll be able to find it earlier, Birx said, diplomatically declining to endorse Trump's unscientific theory. And as you have probably learned, one of the experts who is supposed to be working on a vaccine was demoted in the Trump government. His name is Rick Bright, and he was removed on Tuesday as director of the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority over at the National at HHS, I believe, and then moved to a lower position at the National Institutes of Health. Why? I resisted efforts to fund potentially dangerous drugs promoted by those with political connections. Specifically, and contrary to misguided directives, I limited the broad use of chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine promoted by the administration as a panacea, but which clearly lack scientific merit. While I am prepared to look at all options and think outside the box, I rightly resisted efforts to provide an unproven drug on demand to the American public. So, it was Trump's snake oil that he resisted and that led to his dismissal. He's hired whistleblower attorneys and does seem to have some fight in him. I'll certainly cheer that on. One of the episodes he revealed was that Dr. Bright was pressured to rush access to the drug after the president and Larry Ellison, the chairman and chief technology officer of Oracle, a software company, and he's a deeply odious character. Trump and Ellison had a talk, and Dr. Bright was directed to put in place a nationwide expanded access program to make the drugs available on a broad basis. So this is a very dangerous pattern. We saw Dr. Nancy Messonnier, who told the truth on the day that Trump came back from India, and she got fired. There is a madman who is pretending to preside over this crisis, but only to the extent that it addresses his narcissistic need. Every day I want to remind you that we are running the Peter B. Collins Podcast Community Fund. And maybe you're one of those people in Florida who hasn't gotten your unemployment check yet, or in many other states. We've got $100 grants funded by listeners and seed money from yours truly. And all you have to do is send me an email, peter@peterbcollins.com. And we will probably grant your requests. I haven't turned anybody down yet. Also, if you want to make a contribution, you can go to PayPal, link to my email address, and contribute any amount of money. Or you can use the U.S. mail and send it to my P.O. Box number 150660, San Rafael, California, 94915. Well, on the front page of the San Francisco Chronicle, an article by a reporter I know, Carolyn Saeed, today, is unfortunately a promotional piece for the use of smartphones for contact tracing. And as we know, contact tracing is important to dealing with a disease of this kind. But think about how we have treated people who contract a venereal disease. And they have to go to their partners and say, "Sweetie, I gave you the clap. And would you want your smartphone to deliver a message like that?" Well, that's what they're promoting here. And in Boston, in Massachusetts, they are using personal contact, phone calls, from state workers. And I find that much more acceptable than trusting that data collected by my phone, because it was near your phone and you got tested and were found positive for COVID. I think it is so creepy and such an invasion of the little privacy we have remaining. So they quote Tina White, a Stanford doctoral candidate who originated COVID Watch, an app being developed by dozens of volunteers. It's also altruistic, so your friends and family can get informed earlier and take the right actions. It's a very pro-social thing to do. And we're told that to ensure that they uncover as many contacts as possible, smartphone apps need widespread adoption. Let me quote from the article. Even though all the U.S. app developers pledge strict privacy controls, it's a big hurdle to ask people to install apps that will monitor their movements and contacts. But some public health experts think that citizens might become more amenable to monitoring, considering the alternatives. They quote Josh Michaud, Associate Director for Global Health Policy at the nonprofit Kaiser Family Foundation. This could be your ticket out of shelter in place. It's a small sacrifice of downloading an app and keeping it on the phone for monitoring. Whew. I'm not ready for that. Want to recommend a great piece today at the Gray Zone Project under the byline of its editor, Max Blumenthal and Ajit Singh. And it exposes step by step how this phony meme that is unproven, and even the people who promote it admit it, is that the coronavirus originated in the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And the Gray Zone investigative piece takes you through a sequence of arguments and evidence showing that a Washington Post reporter who has carried water for the government in the past, well, he started promoting this idea on April 14th in a dubiously sourced column. He's a neoconservative pundit whose bio lists past work at the Japanese embassy. He has spent years agitating for regime change against the countries comprising the Bush administration's axis of evil. And the columnist's hypothesis rested largely on a January 2018 cable from the U.S. Embassy in Beijing. I've reported on that. That embassy officers inspected this lab and reported that, it wasn't up to snuff from their point of view. So then the day after Rogan's op-ed appeared, right-wing Fox News correspondent Brett Baer published a strikingly similar piece. Then Tom Cotton went on, you guessed it, Fox News, using Baer's reporting, showing that the Chinese Communist Party is responsible for every single death, job loss, all of the impacts of the virus. Then Mike Pompeo piled on the next day, elevating the baseless theory to the global stage. Quote, we are still asking the Chinese Communist Party to allow experts to get into that virology lab so we can determine precisely where this virus began. Then we move to Israel, where a former lieutenant colonel in Israeli military intelligence, Danny Shoham, has promoted the idea while conceding, so far, there isn't evidence or indication for such an incident. And that would be leakage in the lab or a worker there who got accidentally infected. Then Radio Free Asia picked up the message. That's propaganda arm of the U.S. government. So you get the picture. I've linked to this important expose, and I encourage you to check it out at thegrayzoneproject.com. Joe Lauria over at Consortium News has a good piece today. You may have heard about the so-called fake social media message promoted by Chinese agents to sow panic in the United States about essentially a call for martial law that could have occurred back in March. And what Joe exposes here is that it wasn't Chinese agents who originated these fake messages. It was the right-wing Washington Examiner in a column by Paul Bedard. And essentially, the almost phrase by phrase, the information that the New York Times attributed to Chinese intelligence came from a right-wing rag in Washington, D.C. Good piece at the Guardian today. They do some excellent enterprise reporting in the United States, and they compare the plight of people in Detroit who can't afford to pay their water bill and that they are getting a short-term temporary moratorium on having their water shut off. But the big beverage companies, Coke and Pepsi, bottle Detroit Metropolitan Water District product under the Dasani label for Coke, and I'm not sure what Pepsi brands it as. They sell the water for about 133 times what they pay for it, but it comes in a pretty bottle and it's got a nice label on it. And it appears that Coca-Cola sometimes doesn't pay its water bill. And unlike poor people who get cut off when the bill is $150 and 60 days past due, well, between April and July of 2017, billing records show that Coca-Cola had a $77,000 balance that went unpaid for 90 days. And later, a bill for $108,000. Oh, I guess that's a Pepsi bill. Also, that went well past the due date. And speaking of water, the Supreme Court ruled today, rejecting the Trump administration's watering down of the Clean Water Act based on a lawsuit from Maui in Hawaii, one of my favorite islands in the chain there. The court ruled 6-3 that a wastewater treatment plant on Maui could not avoid provisions of the Clean Water Act by first pumping water from the wastewater plant into the ground and then letting it leach into the ocean. So I think that's an important ruling. There's also a great analytical piece about the ruling I talked about earlier this week, Ramos versus Louisiana. And it really ended up only applying to Oregon, which was the last state to allow a jury to convict without a unanimous vote. But what Linda Greenhouse unpacks for us, I think, is fascinating for people who care about the law and the court. So I'm running pretty long here, and I'm not going to go into great detail, but it shows basically that each of the nine justices voted the way they did for different reasons, and notably that Brett Kavanaugh used the opportunity to try to set the groundwork for departing from precedent or stare decisis in the future. Greenhouse writes, Justice Kavanaugh's 18-page concurring opinion, which no other justice joined, included a list of 30 of the court's most notable and consequential decisions that overturned earlier rulings, a kind of 30 ways to leave your lover inventory of decisions that occupied the ideological spectrum from Brown versus the Board of Education to Citizens United. And she suggests that he's laying the groundwork to overturn Roe versus Wade, which Senator Susan Collins pressed him to define as a precedent that should not be touched. So you may have heard that Iran launched a satellite into outer space yesterday, producing consternation in the Let's Have a War with Iran wing of the Trump administration. And also Trump tweeted a threat at Iran earlier this week to shoot down and destroy Iranian gunboats that harass U.S. ships in the Gulf. Now, let's note that we started this, Trump did, by pulling out of the nuclear deal with Iran. It was an international deal, but he squelched it. Then, earlier this year, it was in January, we assassinated the top Iranian general, Soleimani. And now we're the victims of vicious attacks from these cabin cruisers that have a machine gun on the bow. And you can't shoot down a little speedboat. You can destroy it, but Trump's language is so cartoonish. And so the Iranians claim control of certain parts of the Persian Gulf, and when the U.S. sends our boats in there, they send out these fast boats, and some of them came close to American naval assets. Trump is just looking for an excuse to attack Iran. My final story today is a laugh-out-loud piece of reportage from BuzzFeed. And I thought this was a comedy piece at first, but apparently it's not. The headline reads, Iran-linked accounts tried to flood Twitter with pro-California independence tweets during the coronavirus pandemic. And this is based on a sketchy report from London. Mark Owens, a professor of Middle Eastern Studies, who is also based in Doha, Qatar. He analyzed thousands of posts and found evidence of coordinated activity that he says is intended to sow discord and unrest in the U.S. at a perceived time of weakness. He analyzed 16,000 frickin' tweets, including replies and retweets from more than 8,000 accounts using the hashtag CalExit. Now, these are people promoting an idea that is embraced by only a handful here in California, that we should exit the United States, that we should secede. And I'm always dubious when we have these self-styled experts who say they know who originated social media disinformation, because our, what was it called, something seven, the CIA hacking tools that fell out of our custody. Well, one of those programs allows you to do what we've known we've been able to do for a long time, and that is to attribute communications on the internet to false sources. So you could blame Russia, you could blame China, North Korea, and now it's Iran. And yes, we have had several political movements. There was a guy named Tim Draper who tried twice to set up a ballot measure that voters would approve that would divide California into five states or four states. And yeah, there are a few fringe people who want to form the state of Jefferson, with a dozen or so counties from far north California and 10 or 12 counties from far south Oregon. And these movements are jokes. And if Iran, in fact, is trying to sow discord in the United States, all they got to do is promote the devious claims of Donald Trump on a daily basis. The idea that promoting Cal exit is going to have any impact in any way, it's just crazy. Thanks for listening to all the way to the end of this lengthy daily podcast. I'm Peter B. Collins. Good day.
Happy trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails.